Ebola patient Thomas Eric Duncan has been in isolation at the hospital since Sunday. Meanwhile, his family is under a quarantine order. His son's mother, Louise, his own child, and his two nephews all in one apartment. They've been told some specific things. They can't even go down the stairs, for example. My colleague Anderson Cooper spoke exclusively with Louise earlier this week.
So what did they tell you then that you needed to do?
To stay home. I needed to stay home and monitor my be taking my temperature. They were going to be monitoring all of us. My son should stay home, my nephews, every one of us should stay home for 21 days. And we should not come outside. If we have to come outside, right on the porch, but not get down the stairs.
What did you think when you heard that?
Scary. I'm scary.
And have you gone outside at all?
No, I'm inside, and they did not bring food here. They came late here last night with paperwork for us to sign. That if we step outside, then they're going to take us to court. They don't have committed a crime. But up to this time, they have not brought us any food.
That was Thursday morning, and since then, she has been delivered some food. But for most people, this is totally unfamiliar territory. But not for Dr. Howard Markel. He joins me now. He's a professor of pediatrics and communicable diseases at the University of Michigan, a medical historian and author of the book Quarantine. Thanks for being back on the program, Doc.
Thank you, Sanjay.
You know, when they hear this scenario that I just described, I think it's pretty shocking for a lot of people. But health officials pretty much anywhere in the United States do have this power, right? Well, what is the limit of the power?
Well, the powers are actually quite strong. More than 100 years ago, the Commissioner of Health of New York City was testifying before Congress, and they asked, what are the limits of your powers? And he said, well, Senator, I could make City Hall a quarantine hospital tomorrow if I wanted to. So if indeed the health authorities feel that you're a threat, that you're not cooperating, and that you might infect others, particularly for a very serious disease like Ebola, their powers are extremely strong.
As I understand it, and part of this is from reading your books, frankly, the practice of quarantine, I mean, even the word itself goes back to 14th century Venice. It wasn't Ebola, obviously, they were trying to stop at that time, but it was the Black Plague. Is that right?
Yes, it was bubonic plague, and Venice was one of the major ports of the world at that time, and plague was traveling, just as Ebola is today, and they ordered a quarantinaria, or quarante giorno, which means 40 days. That's where the word quarantine comes from. But ever since that 1375 edict of quarantine, we've been fine-tuning and changing the meaning of the word.
Did it work? I mean, would you say quarantines work? Is there a way to give a context? How well do they work?
Well, this is an eternal question in public health. You know, when it was done back then, and even till, you know, maybe 100 years ago, it was often relied upon as a means of last resort because we didn't have antibiotics or antivirals or vaccines. Today, it's very rarely done, but only for diseases that are very easily transmitted, such as influenza, if it were a deadly form of influenza, because that could be transmitted while you're in close contact with someone if they cough or sneeze at you. And the other one is for a disease that is so novel and so deadly that we don't want to take chances. And so I think Ebola is falling in that latter category. But people have been arguing whether it works or not ever since quarantine was first proposed in the 14th century.
You know, I think a lot of people, when they hear quarantine, they hear these stories, they think about Typhoid Mary. That's a story a lot of people are familiar with. She was a carrier of the disease typhoid, and that means she wasn't sick herself, but she could give it to others. And unfortunately, she was a cook, so she made a lot of people sick. And the city locked her up. For how long was she locked up?
Oh, she was locked up twice. Once they let her out after about 4 or 5 years, and then she went back to cooking. And carriers of typhoid, it's salmonella, carry it in their gallbladder, and it does shed on their hands when they cook. So she got other people sick. And then she spent another decade or more on North Brother Island, which is in the East River of New York City. And I've been there. It's even though you're right near a city, it's about as desolate and lonely a place as you can imagine.
Dr. Howard Markel, it's always good to see you. And I see Ann Arbor, Michigan behind you, according to Forbes magazine, the most educated city in America. I love that we have that in common, sir. Thanks for joining us.
Glad to be here, Sanjay.